fellow freedom fighters, comrades and friends. It is my great pleasure to welcome you to Accra and to this conference of African freedom fighters and supporters of the growing movement for Africa's liberation and unity. It is good for our cause to have a periodic meeting of this kind to examine our position in the great struggle to rid Africa completely and forever of imperialism and its handmaidens, colonialism and neocolonialism. It gives us the opportunity also to review our strength as well as that of the enemy and to reorganize our forces and our strategy in order to carry the struggle forward to victory. We have shaped a destiny for ourselves, and no one can alter the course of that destiny. It is the destiny of complete freedom for Africa, the total liberation of our continent, and its political and economic unification. We have achieved some measure of success in this struggle for human freedom and dignity. But we still have a great task ahead. We can only know the extent of our task and our own strength when we have examined and ascertained that of the enemy. Who is the enemy? Fellow freedom fighters, the enemy is imperialism. Which uses as its weapons colonialism and neocolonialism. Let us be very, very clear about this. Let us also not lose sight of the real objective, which is the liquidation of colonialism and imperialism in all its forms, political, economic, ideological, and the political unification of Africa, our dear continent. Then we must ask, what is imperialism? And what are the forms it has taken? And what other mask is it likely to put on? Modern imperialism arose when capitalism had achieved both industrial and financial monopoly, and the competition for raw materials and markets had made it imperative for the advanced industrialized countries to expand into the less advanced parts of the world. This phenomenon led to the partition of the world among the great powers. Asia and Africa were divided up among them. Fellow freedom fighters and friends, African nationalist thinking has been adjusting to internationalism within the continent, the development process that must lead to the political unification of the African continent. But the objective of African unity can be seriously undermined by tribalism, which provides one of the happiest hunting grounds for the colonialist and new colonialist enemies of African independence and unity. Unless we take this problem of tribalism very carefully in hand, it can undo all our valiant efforts to bring real independence to Africa. We all know the evils of colonialism, but there are some of us who do not appreciate the malevolent possibilities for infinite disruption and even chaos of uncontrolled tribalism, which can make havoc of our hopes and our aspirations. We know that the colonialists are past masters in the policy of divide and rule. They are quick to seize on tribal differences which they discover among us and use this to pit one group against the other. Soon, these superficial differences become exaggerated into serious political factions, which sometimes lead to tragic fratricidal struggles within the same territory. You must guard against it. guard against it by forging a common united front against the common enemy. The dangers it opens up and the manipulations to which it can be put are too numerous and too threatening for us to ignore it, to ignore its urgent demand for critical and constructive attention. Failure in this task would only risk all the efforts and sacrifices that we have made so far in our common cause and place in jeopardy the future peace and development of the continent. I therefore charge you to place high on your agenda and to give it your most thoughtful and creative consideration. Colonial rule has left a high degree of illiteracy among our people. And we all know that in conditions of ignorance and superstition, it is easy enough to fan internecine feuds. This menace can be met by unity among the leaders and the creation of a nationwide, firmly knit political organization receiving the most complete loyalty and devoted service from all its members, especially its officers and organizing officials in the field. Colonial rule has left the masses of our people poverty-stricken, disease-ridden, while enormous quantities of mineral and agricultural wealth were drained out of Africa year in and year out. I am not making this point merely in order to harrow you with ugly memories. Many of you have been confronted only too recently with the shocking actualities of calculated oppression to be able at this moment to push them out of your mind. I raise this point so that it will stay in your minds when you may be tempted by the seductive promises of new colonialism to forget the real character of colonialist imperialism and be persuaded away from your own true interests and those of Africa. For today, we must each see ourselves as part of Africa in order that we may face colonialist imperialism and its new form, new colonialism, on a continent-wide front. First, the attainment of freedom and independence. Secondly, the consolidation of that freedom and independence. Thirdly, the creation of unity and community between the free African states. Fourth, the economic and social reconstruction of Africa. I must again urge the United Nations to see to it that its own declaration on the liquidation of colonialism is given practical effect without further delay. So long as colonialism exists in Africa, Africans cannot help talking the way we do now. And mankind cannot escape the constant threat of war. Africa therefore appeals to the United Nations to live up to its reputation as the greatest bastion of world peace and demands that a meeting of this year's United Nations session should be devoted to the problem of colonialism in Africa. It is folly. It is folly for the colonialists to think that they can hold back forever the progress of history. The process of change is inherent in the interplay of social, economic, and political forces. It is true that these can be hindered and impeded and even bent to different purposes, but not forever. However,
we end up with injustice, we end up with corruption, we end up with poverty, we end up with the worst possible things, we end up with the image. I don't have to tell you the image that you have in Africa. I don't have to tell you. Listen, when I was in office,
to give history as an effort, a revolutionary push.
I trained. in the cities. When I became an Air Force pilot,
we must adopt a positive all-out anti-colonialist, anti-imperialist attack.
That's when I saw.
And this quickly, for we cannot afford the luxury
of today. There's a big difference
between
those of us living in the cities and the mass
time
people
asks
who
for
feed
the enemy,
us
no less than for
in
ourselves.
The rural areas.
Let us therefore,
my brother,
examine our position seriously and objectively.
The water
to see
the
how
drink
well we have managed so far. And evaluate our points of weakness and the necessary remedies.
The water you use to
let
flush
us,
your
let
toilet,
us determine what modifications are needed
our
to adjust
in the
our
cities
strategy
is much cleaner
the
than the water they
the
drink in the villages. No clinic, no hospitals, etc. No headache, no needles to even
this
sew their clothes.
Plain speaking.
That's when I began to see
that for the sake of
the
Africa,
parasitic, the plain parasitic relationship between our cities and our this land.
As
I mean,
see,
I've seen too much injustice in my country.
Our greatest danger.
When I decided enough
from
was enough.
Unity.
When some of
and
us began to decide that
to
something has to be done about
that
it.
That the realization of our hopes and aspirations.
When we emerged into
the
political
the realization
office,
of our objective of total
you know
African independence.
Electricity used to be limited to only 27% of the country.
Is in,
in the shortest possible time, we were able to, with Italian assistance,
and actions in
we were able to extend electricity from 27 to almost 87%
of
the rest of the country. We were able to extend roads.
We must therefore
the infrastructure
the issue
was
of African unity
every
now
part of the country.
For only unity
I mean,
will make
beautiful
the artificial boundaries and regional I mean, demarcations imposed by colonialism.
Energy now goes to every part of the village. Children can now go to school
African unity will
and can learn at night
an
so that my children living in the cities will not have an advantage over that child in the village. My
in
child
the United Africa,
has no superior,
there
was
be
not
no
born with anything superior
Ethiopia
than
Somalia,
a child in the village.
Or between Zanzibar
but so
and
long
Kenya,
as that child in the village
Liberia,
is denied and
or between Ghana,
of
Togoland
electricity
and the
to learn at night and,
because,
and good water, etc. My child in the city will always have the advantage over the ones in the rural
you,
areas.
We would regard
I've been
ourselves
to school
as
where
one great
rural students were doing
boundary
better with the passage of
some
time
of leaders,
than those of us in the cities.
Do not see
please,
this
I know the potential
of
humanity.
Their brother Africans
so when you're talking
their
about
own struggle,
the effects of some of these things,
even if they did, they would
you
not
know,
be free.
These superpowers
to express
must,
their solidarity
must learn to accommodate and to live and to accept patriotic leadership, patriotic citizens.
Africans,
too often,
where they can sit
too
back
often, they are more, they are happier
watch,
with
watch
people who are not patriots.
As well
but
as
you,
contempt
in Europe, excuse me, don't get angry.
See,
you never seem to know the role that some of your bad businessmen, you have good businessmen, and I respect
regrettably
them. But some of your bad businessmen
those days
are always
some
doing bribe,
who were
you know,
among
bad
the freedom fighters
my,
of yesterday
on our continent,
and who haven't
and
won their independence.
Suffer.
Are willing to
this
drop
kind of
it
thing must stop.
For some
your governments must begin to wake up
and thereby
to help us,
deny to those
to help us,
for freedom,
to help to police and to maintain the integrity of economic policies and economic practices
against
in my country.
All
your country must help us to protect the judiciary
guard,
in my country. Your country
even
must help
I
us to,
poli-
to police
admit,
and to monitor
I
and to protect the political integrity in our country.
Willingly to the colonialist
what is it about the Negro? I mean, every other
this
group
time,
that came as an immigrant
they
somehow,
don't even have to,
not easily,
they don't
but somehow got around it. Is it just the fact that Negroes are black?
White America must
it
see
makes one wonder
that
why
no
so
other ethnic group has been a slave on American
and
soil.
So many types
that is one thing that other immigrant groups
place
haven't had to face.
If it
the other thing is that the
be
color.
So
became a stigma. American society
surrender
made the Negro's color a stigma. America freed the slaves
colonialism
in 1863 through the Emancipation
intellectual
Proclamation
allegiances
of Abraham
which
Lincoln,
are not
but gave the slaves
the
no land on nothing in reality.
To condition loyalties
fact,
away from
to,
Africa
to get started on.
Metropolis,
at the same time, America was giving away millions of acres of land in the West and the Midwest, which meant that there was a willingness to give the white peasants from Europe an economic base. And yet it refused to give its black peasants from Africa, who came here involuntarily in chains and had worked free for 244 years, any kind of economic base. And so emancipation for the Negro was really freedom to hunger. It was freedom to the winds and rains of heaven. It was freedom without food to eat or land to cultivate, and therefore it was freedom and famine at the same time. And when white Americans tell the Negro to lift himself by his own bootstraps, they don't look over the legacy of slavery and segregation. I believe we ought to do all we can and seek to lift ourselves by our own bootstraps. But it's a cruel jest to say to a bootless man that he ought to lift himself by his own bootstraps. And many Negroes, by the thousands and millions, have been left bootless as a result of all of these years of oppression and as a result of a society that deliberately made his color a stigma and something worthless and degrading.
For rising standards of living and better social conditions, but charged with economies that can hardly meet the recurrent expenses of administration and maintenance. They are in dilemma. And standing at their elbows are the new colonialist agents, beckoning them back with a smile into the web of imperialism, though it may have a new look this time and offer the irresistible bit of immediate help. But this help, will be far outweighed, as they will experience with no great loss of time by the knots into which their economies will be tied by the Euro-African Association. Imperialism does not change its nature. It only changes its front. It still needs colonial appendages, whether in name or in fact, to exploit and at the same time to support its Cold War strategy. In the face of this serious threat to our economy and independence in Africa, we must begin to build immediately our own continental common market. For it is easy for anyone who studies the common market organization closely to realize that the common market is aimed at harnessing the African countries to satisfy the profit lust of the imperialist bloc and to prevent us from following an independent neutralist policy. It is easy to see that the imperialists and the colonialists are determined to retain the African countries in the position of suppliers of cheap raw materials. If we do not resist this threat, and if we throw in our lot with the common market, we shall doom the economy of Africa to a state of perpetual subjection to the economy of Western Europe. This will, of course, hinder the industrialization of our young African states. It is impossible to think of economic development and national independence without possessing an unfettered capacity for maintaining a strong industrial power. The activities of the common market are therefore fraught with dangerous political and economic consequences for the independent African states. The organization constitutes an attempt to replace the old system of colonial exploitation by a new system of collective colonialism, which will be stronger and more dangerous than the old evils we are striving to liquidate from our continent. There is an alternative to Euro-African Association with these deadly implications for Africa's independence and progress. It is in an African economic community in which we can all pull our production and our trade to a common advantage. It is not difficult to imagine that the new colonialists would describe this as a pooling of poverty. It is, however, too simple a distortion of fact. Africa is rich and not poor. As the great wealth that has been taken out of our continent over five centuries of despoliation and extortion, very well put. Africa has immense actual and potential wealth. Gold, diamond, copper, manganese, bauxite, iron ore, uranium, asbestos, chrome, cobalt, a host of other minerals. Our essential cultural produce have all been drained away by colonialist imperialism. Africa is far from being poor. It is Africans who are poor, not Africa. And they are poor because of the uncounted profit that has been made out of the exploitation of their labor and their lands. If we are being bidden to enter a European community, we must have something that community needs, and needs badly, when it pretends to offer a bonus by way of aid. When Greeks come bearing grapes, should we not look them well in the mouth? If I may mix my metaphor. But I'm sure you get my meaning. When we, new, untried, inexperienced states, are flattered into European alliance, we enter not as equals, but as suppliers of primary products at the generosity of industrial competitors. How generous they can be, we have learned from our sad experience over a good long time. Who fixes the prices? Who can play off one against the other by allowing the goods of associates in free of tariff and placing a tariff on others? As long as it is possible to deal with this singly, one by one, we are at the mercy of the imperialists rather than their generosity. And we shall find ourselves in the same old cleft stake of receiving the lowest possible prices for our raw materials, while those of us who are obliged to buy their manufactured goods because of being members of the association will pay for them through the nose. These same states will find themselves tied up in knots which will prevent their going into an open market for their needs of goods and capital investment. And above all, they will lose their option of non-alignment and find themselves dragged into the diplomacy of imperialist Cold War politics, which will operate against the independence and intrinsic interests of Africa. Those of us who cannot see through these implications can only be suffering from an intense myopia. Within our African community, our pooled production will place us in a position to bargain for higher prices and so secure greater revenues out of which we can invest in our development. At the same time, we can trade freely among ourselves and buy from ourselves in the cheapest markets. we can turn for aid to those sources which will give us the most suitable terms while leaving us free to follow our own internal and external policy. But more even than this narrow cooperation, we need a wider continental economic plan which will allow us, within unity, to exploit Africa's tremendous resources for our common welfare and greater African development and progress. If we are really sincere in our desire to see the end of imperialism in Africa, then, apart even from the consideration involved in African unity, we should turn away from any form of association with Europe, which, through its new colonialist control of our policies, will help rather to sustain that imperialism and undermine it. It is bad enough that our economies, as a legacy of colonial rule, are imperialist controlled, and that we have to strive every means to rid ourselves of this economic imperialism and secure our development and progress on solid African foundations. This is another reason why we should come together in a unified African economic plan, which, operating on a continental scale, can make a solid attack on the imperialist domination in Africa. We should, without delay, aim at the creation of a joint African military command. There is little wisdom in our present separate effort to build up and maintain defense forces, which, in any case, would be ineffective in a major world conflict. If we examine this problem realistically, we would ask, which single African state could protect itself against an imperialist aggressor? And how much more difficult this would be when some states are allowing the imperialists to maintain bases on their territories. I have already referred to the military forces which South Africa is raising and the danger it poses for the new African states and the struggle of those still in chains. Only our unity can provide us with anything like adequate protection. If we do not unite and combine our military forces, South Africa, along with her allies or any other colonialist imperialist power, can pick us off one by one. Not only that, some of us, out of a sense of insecurity, may be drawn into making defense pacts with imperialists, which will endanger the security of us all. It follows that if we set up in Africa a common economic planning organization and a joint military command, we shall have to work out and adopt a common foreign policy to give political direction to our continental development and our continental defense. Fellow freedom fighters, you may perhaps wonder why I have dwelt at some length with these problems of the unity of independent African states and what relevance they have to our immediate problems of how to overcome the obstacles standing in the way of your own struggle and independence as freedom fighters. I think I have answered any such questions by pointing out that the dangers to the whole subject of your fight for freedom in the fragmentary state of Africa at this present time. Moreover, the moment you have achieved your independence, you will be faced with the practical problems of protecting that independence and securing your viability in order to lay the foundations on which you build up economic and social development. You must know where you are going what avenues of support await you, which will contribute to your real consolidation and protection amid the problems that will confront you. Those problems can best be met within a unified Africa, and it should be possible in the higher reaches of our endeavor to devise a constitutional structure which will secure the objectives I have outlined, and yet preserve the sovereignty of each of the countries joining the Union. Countries within the Union will naturally maintain their own constitutions, continue to use their own national emblems and national anthems and other symbols and paraphernalia of sovereignty. Regional associations and territorial groupings can only be other forms of balkanization unless they are conceived within the framework of a continental union. There are existing models which we can modify or adapt to our pattern. The United States of America, the Soviet Union, India and China have proved the efficacy of unions embracing large stretches of land and population. When the first 13 states of America tried to promote the idea of a United States, this was ridiculed as an empty dream and vigorously resisted by many. Today, America is the foremost industrial country in the world, and the states within her union number 50 states. And who would have thought that almost 100 different peoples of various levels of economic, social, and political development could have been welded into the mighty state which the Soviet Union has become in such space of time. Such short space of time. For example, the example of Europe, which is left in confusion after centuries of mutually destructive economic warfare and competition, because it failed to build a sound foundation for common political action and understanding, should be a lesson for us all. But with the exigencies created by the shrinking of empires, the growing socialist world, and the need generated by the greater productive capacities inherent in present-day techniques, even Europe is now beginning to seek its common association. It is paradoxical, therefore, that some African states should be turning away from their proper African affiliations to those of other continents. Rather, we should all be working ceaselessly to bring to fruition the fond hope of African unity, to which we all give lip service and to which most of us are resolutely dedicated. And now, fellow freedom fighters, let me say a few words about the sad development in what looked like hopeful moves towards the unity of the Caribbean islands. It may sound far-fetched, but it has a meaning to us as Africans. We regard West Indians as our brothers. For they have strong ties of kinship with us here in Africa. They, like us, have suffered and are still suffering the iniquities of colonial oppression. I think it's only right that we should show concern over any development which tends to undermine their solidarity and progress. And we have indeed been saddened by the failure of the attempt at federation. How can these little islands hope to stand by themselves in the future any better than they have done in the past? When the trend is toward the creation of bigger units of economic viability, it is most distressing to find that some of our brothers across the Atlantic seem to be unaware of the vital needs of the widest possible federation, drawn together by a central government with sufficient powers to make the principle of unified progress a working possibility. It would be tragic. Yes, tragic. Not only for the West Indians, but also for Africans and other people of African descent. If the islands in the West Indies were to remain apart. For we have reposed so much hope and faith in the emergence of the Caribbean islands as the United States, free and progressive, federated in strength and purpose, and contributing substantially to the total success of our peoples. I hope that the West Indian leaders, who are men of learning and progress, will see the folly and danger of this disuniting development and arrest the process for the good of all concerned. And that's true now. Here in Africa, the increasing activity of freedom fighters all over the continent is one of the most hopeful signs of the victory that must crown our efforts. Many have to take what is not ours. But we have a perfect right to fight for the birthright of freedom and the ownership of our land that has been filched up from us and is being illegally withheld. Inasmuch as our struggle for independence and our subsequent national and continental development is bound up with the question of peace, since our very survival hangs upon the decisions of the great nations, we once more put forward our appeal to them. Immeasurable quantities of money, not to talk of the futile waste of energy, brains, and productive capacity, and put into the manufacture and explosion of most lethal weapons of destruction that man has ever bent his ingenuity to devise. It is a fair comment on the state of Western civilization that this should be regarded as its highest pinnacle of achievement, while millions of the world's population in Asia and Africa, yes, even in Europe and America, exist on the fringe of bare subsistence. We call upon the powers who hold the fate of mankind in their hands to turn away from the production of these appalling means of mass destruction and to devote to peaceful use the harness power of the atom. How excellent it would be if, instead of preparing for the destruction of mankind, one barest part of the means financing it could be used in the rapid development of the less developed parts of the world, and thus destroy colonialist imperialism forever. It is a sad reflection on the leadership of these nations that they should have within their reach the power for doing good and yet refuse to adjust themselves to the opportunity for making effective their ability for doing good. I hope that before long, sanity may prevail and that mankind will receive the benefits of the uncountable wealth now being catapulted into the atmosphere. Long live African freedom fighters. Long live African independence. Long live your struggle. Yeah. And long live African unity. Yeah.